Let's look at the nomenclature and physical properties of carboxylic acids. And we'll start with nomenclature. So if we wanted to name this carboxylic acid, it's the simplest one possible. There's one carbon, so a one-carbon carboxylic acid. If we had a one-carbon alkane, we would call that methane. To name a carboxylic acid, you drop the E ending and add oic acid. And so this one would be methanoic acid. So let me go ahead and write this out. So methanoic acid, you can see we've dropped the E and added oic and then acid. Methanoic acid is the IUPAC name for this molecule. The common name for this is formic acid, which is what you'll hear more often. So formic acid. And the name comes from the Latin word for ant, because formic acid is found in ant venom. And there are lots of really cool carboxylic acids with interesting common names, such as this example here. All right, let's look at this one. So a two-carbon carboxylic acid. So using IUPAC nomenclature, that would be ethanoic acid, right? So it would be ethane, drop the E, add oic acid. So ethanoic acid. The common name for this is acetic acid. And so once again, that's the one that you'll hear more often. So acetic acid. And this name comes from the Latin word for vinegar, because vinegar is just a dilute solution of acetic acid in water. All right, let's name this one down here. So you want to find the longest carbon chain that includes the carbon of your carboxylic acid. So that's going to make this carbon over here carbon number one. So 2, 3, 4, 5. So a 5-carbon carboxylic acid. That would be pentanoic acid. So go ahead and write pentanoic acid here. So pentanoic acid. And then we have a bromine on carbon 4. And so it'd be 4-bromo. And so the full IUPAC name would be 4-bromopentanoic acid. All right, let's look at this one. So 3 carbons. So this would be carbon number 1. 2 and 3. So a 3-carbon carboxylic acid would be propanoic acid, but since we have a double bond present, we need to change the A to an E, so it'd be propenoic acid. So let me go ahead and write this out. So it'd be propene, so we have to have an E here, propenoic acid, like that. And then we can just go ahead and put in a 2 here to indicate the start of the double bond, so 2-propenoic acid. We don't have to worry about the stereochemistry of the double bond, since that's a monosubstituted double bond. But for longer carboxylic acid, you would have to think about the stereochemistry. All right, let's do some more examples. So let's look at this molecule over here on the bottom left. And we can see there's a benzene ring, right, attached to a carboxylic acid. And so we've seen this before, and we called it benzoic acid. So let's go ahead and start that as our parent name. So we have benzoic acid right here. And then if we're going to name it as benzoic acid, that gives the carbon attached to the carboxylic acid carbon number 1. And then we want to give our substituent the lowest number possible. So of course, this is going to be carbon number 2. And we have an OH carbon 2. So it's 2-hydroxybenzoic acid. So 2-hydroxybenzoic acid. Benzoic acid is actually a common name, but it's, again, used so frequently in organic chemistry, it's been incorporated into IUPAC nomenclature. If we wanted to name this another way, we could say it's 2-hydroxy or ortho-hydroxy. Right? And then we see there's a benzene ring, so 2-hydroxybenzene. And then we have our carboxylic acid. So 2-hydroxybenzene carboxylic acid is another IUPAC name for this molecule. You don't see people name it that way usually, just because it's so long and it's just much easier to say benzoic acid. The common name for this molecule is salicylic acid. So let me go ahead and write that. So salicylic acid is famous because it's a precursor to aspirin and wintergreen. So the name for salicylic acid comes from the Latin word for willow tree, because you can get this compound from the bark of the willow tree. And the Greeks knew about this, and it would reduce fevers and decrease pain. And so that's, of course, why salicylic acid was transformed into aspirin. All right, let's look at this one over here on the right. And so instead of having a benzene ring, we have a cyclohexane ring. So this would be cyclohexane. And now we have our carboxylic acid. So over here, so we could say cyclohexane carboxylic acid for this one. So cyclohexane, almost running out of room here, carboxylic acid, like that. So instead of saying benzene carboxylic acid, it's cyclohexane carboxylic acid. All right, so what do you do if you have two carboxylic acids in the same molecule? And so that's what we have here. We can see there are two carbons present. So we go ahead and start by writing ethane. All right, so we have two carboxylic acids. So we're going to use di in here. So ethane di, and now oic. So ethane dioic acid would be the IUPAC name for this molecule. The common name for this molecule is oxalic acid. So oxalic acid, like that. All right, let's look at properties of carboxylic acids. So we'll start with boiling point. And so let's compare these two molecules in terms of their boiling point. So over here on the left, we have acetic acid, which has a boiling point of approximately 118 degrees Celsius. And over here on the right, we have ethanol. And the boiling point of ethanol is approximately 78 degrees Celsius. So acetic acid has a higher boiling point. And we can think about why by thinking about two molecules of acetic acid interacting and the intermolecular forces that are present. So let's go ahead and draw another molecule of acetic acid. So I'm going to go ahead and draw it. So there's my carbonyl, and then we have an oxygen, and then a hydrogen, and on this side, a methyl group. Right, so there are opportunities for hydrogen bonding, right? So there could be a hydrogen bond right here, right? Because, and a hydrogen bond right here. So remember, oxygen is more electronegative than hydrogen. So oxygen gets a partial negative, the hydrogen gets a partial positive, and then this oxygen over here is also partially negative. And so you have this opposite charges attracting, right? This partially negatively charged oxygen attracted to this partially positively charged hydrogen here, and this is your hydrogen bond, right? The strongest intermolecular force, right? The same thing down here. So we can think about two hydrogen bonds forming for two molecules of acetic acid, right? And over here on the right, we have ethanol. So let's go ahead and draw in another molecule of ethanol. Right, so here we have our second molecule of ethanol, and we can see there could be a hydrogen bond right here. So once again, we have our partially negative oxygen, partially positive hydrogen, partial negative oxygen, like that. So we have one hydrogen bond. And so there's more opportunities for hydrogen bonding in acetic acid than in ethanol. And so because there are more opportunities for hydrogen bonding, right, there's stronger forces holding these two molecules together. And so it takes more energy to pull them apart. And that's the reason why it has a higher boiling point. All right, let's think about solubility in water. So, and let's stick with thinking about acetic acid right here. So we know acetic acid is soluble in water because vinegar is acetic acid in water. And so if we don't have a lot of carbons, right, so acetic acid has only two carbons, this molecule is polar enough to dissolve in water. So we could show acetic acid interacting with water, right? So let me go ahead and draw a water molecule right here. And I'll draw a water molecule over here. And so there's, of course, some hydrogen bonding that can go on, right? So you can think about a hydrogen bond right here and a hydrogen bond right here. And so acetic acid is soluble in water. Water is a polar molecule, and acetic acid is polar enough to dissolve in water. However, as you increase the number of carbons in your R group, right? So as you increase the number of carbons, you get more carbons and hydrogens, and so you get more of a nonpolar character. And the more nonpolar you make this molecule, the more you decrease its solubility in water. So once you get past somewhere around 5 or 6 carbons, you decrease the solubility dramatically. And so that's just a little bit into the physical properties and the nomenclature of carboxylic acids.